Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. If any man defile the temple of God, God will destroy him. And we shared with you this morning, going back to Ezekiel chapter 8, as last week we had preached concerning the hole in the wall that Israel had built up between them and God because of the abominations they had brought into God's temple. And in Ephesians chapter 8, verse 2, it said, "Then I beheld, and lo, a likeness, as the appearance of fire, from the appearance of his loins, even downward, fire, and from his loins, even upward, as the appearance of brightness, as the color of amber." I shared with you this morning that the reason this man, possibly the Lord himself or a messenger from the Lord, is described with such a fiery appearance is because of his anger concerning the abominations that have been brought into the house of God. And so we took you to several scriptures in the Old Testament. And at one point in the message, I had mentioned that some will say, "Oh yes, the wrath of God, that's Old Testament." Well, tonight we want to look at the New Testament. So in Matthew chapter 3, verses 11 and 12, turn with me. John the Baptist is speaking here. He said, "I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand. And he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner. But he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." So here John the Baptist, the forerunner of Christ, and describing some things about the ministry that the Lord Jesus Christ would be involved in. How he had baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire. But some of his ministry of the Lord would have to do with a purging, with a separation. One place Jesus said, "I came not to bring peace, but a sword." And often it is a dividing a sword. Said, "Whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge." What's the next word?
His
floor. Not just any floor, but his floor.
Yeah.
Now, I don't want to read too much into this, but to me it's pretty obvious that his floor must be in his house. Wouldn't you think so?
Yeah.
If it's his floor, it must be in his house. And what is his house? The house of God is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth.
Yes.
And here we're told of this floor that's going to be his, which implies that he will have a house, that a part of his ministry is that there will be a house clean. Amen. And that which is in it, which should not be, that which is unclean, is going to be swept. It's going to be gathered together, and it's going to be cast into unquenchable fire. And all that's going to be left is just the good of wheat, but the chaff having been separated. Now, this is talk. What you talking about? Has Jesus quit the ministry and become a farmer? Well, what is this wheat? What is this chaff? It's talking about people.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
It's talking about you and I. And even more specifically, when you're talking about His Lord, in that context, it's talking about members of the church in His house. Some things that are in His house are going to stay in it. When that spirit of judgment and that spirit of burning that we preached about this morning, that fire that will be in Zion, it spoke of those who are left in Zion. I don't want to be swept out. How about you? And I certainly don't want to be burned out. I want to be part of that good wheat. But you see, this tells us that in the New Testament and in the church of God and even concerning the person of Jesus Christ, that there is judgment. There is wrath of God against evildoers. Now, Jesus said in one place that it's not His will that any should perish. But still, people have a free will as to how they are going to respond to the commandments of the Lord Jesus Christ. Whether they will be faithful and observe the all things. And if they will, they will be blessed. Now understand, Jesus did not come to condemn the world. The world was already under condemnation because all had sinned. And God, being a just God and hating sin, sin had to be punished. And we were under that sentence of punishment. But Jesus came that the world through Him might be saved. That's the good news. That we can believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be faithful unto Him and what He has taught us concerning His will, and we can be saved. But if we reject that, it's a serious thing. God is a God of wrath. Now, really, some of my main theme here. We have a couple or two or three who were not here this morning.
Amen.
Some of my main thing has to do with the fear of God. Yes, the fear of Him, a reverential fear of His awesomeness, of His greatness. And I believe that. But I don't want to use that to sort of a sugarcoat or soft pedal the wrath of God that we are to have a fear of in the New Testament, in the church of God. It is Bible. Oh, God, give us a restoration of the fear of God in the church of God. Matthew chapter 21, verses 12 through 14, we have an example of what I'm talking about here. And Jesus went into the temple of God. Now I believe this was prophetic concerning the cleansing of His holy temple of the church of God. And Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out all them that sold and bought in the temple and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves. And He said unto them, it is written, my house. Yeah. Hallelujah. His house. spiritually, that would be the church of God. He said, my house shall be called the house of prayer, but ye have made it a den of thieves. We're getting closer to that time that the Lord Jesus Christ is going to be swinging his broom more than ever before. He's going to be popping his whip in the church of God more than ever before. He's going to cleanse his house. Everything that is not what it should be will be driven out. But notice this, the very next verse said, and the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. Hallelujah. He's loving, he's compassionate, he's caring. He offers healing of body, soul, and spirit. But for those who rise up against him and reject him, he's fierce in his wrath. He's a jealous God, but he is also a merciful God. Hallelujah. As I mentioned this morning concerning John 3:16, and I misquoted that a little intentionally. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should have everlasting life. That's usually what people think of when they hear that verse. And I wanted to think of that. That's good and well. But what about that clause that said that they should not perish if they believe on him? But if they do not believe on him, what's going to happen? They are going to perish. God is a God of judgment. He is angry with the wicked every day. And if this were not so, perhaps God could have found another way to save the world. He could have just said, all is forgiven. But no, he says, if you do not believe, that you will perish. On one occasion, he talked about a tower that had fallen and killed several men. And he said, don't just suppose that they were sinners above others, and that's why that tower fell upon them. He said, except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Okay? Now, the prime example of which every Bible scholar here expects me to get to, amen, in Acts chapter 5. But a certain man named Ananias, with Sapphira his wife, sold a possession and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. Now, it seems that as so many of the early Christians sold their possessions and began to have all things in common, that here this man and his wife, they pretend to sell it, everything or whatever they sold to give all the proceeds from the sale to the church. But it was a false pretense. They didn't do what they had said that they were doing. But Peter said, Ananias, why have Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? Now I tell you, I haven't promised God, and I haven't told you. I've sold my house, I've sold my car, sold everything I've had, and I've given it to the church. I have not promised to do that. I have not covenanted to do that. Amen? Amen. But here,
They were lying to the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
That is a fearful thing. When people become a member of the Church of God, and they say, I will, and they know the obligations of faithfulness that go along with that, it is a fearful thing to be a covenant breaker. And so here, in a sense, that's what was happening. So Peter said, why have Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price? Whilst it remained, was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power? Of your own free will, you made a choice to make that commitment and to make the promises and to say, this is the way it will be, that this is the commitment that I'm making to God. You didn't have to do that, but you did. Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God. And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost. And here it is. And great fear. Can everybody say great fear?
Great.
And great fear came on all of them that heard these things. Oh, that great fear would come upon those who have said, I will. And then they failed to live up to that commitment. And he died there on the spot. And great fear came on all them that heard these things. Let me tell you, in the Church of God, in these last days, if people make vows and promises, they say, I will do this, and they lie to the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
If the judgment of God does not come upon them, God owes an apology to Ananias and Sapphira.
Amen.
And so the young men arose, wound him up, and carried him out, and buried him. And it was about the space of 3 hours later when his wife, not knowing what was done, came in. And Peter answered unto her, tell me whether ye sold the land for so much. And she said, yea, for so much. Notice the boldness of the apostle. Didn't you make a certain commitment? Didn't you make a certain promise to God Almighty? She said, yes. Then Peter said unto her, how is it that ye have agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord?
Amen.
When people make vows to God and they fail to keep up, be faithful to it, they are tempting God Almighty.
Amen.
Behold, the feet of them which have buried thy husband are at the door and shall carry thee out. God's no respecter of persons. Then fell she down straightway at his feet and yielded up the ghost, and the young men came in and found her dead, and carrying her forth, buried her by her husband. And here it is again. And I'm going to let you repeat these phrases after me. And great fear came upon all the church. Would you say that together? And great fear came upon all the church.
Amen.
Not just 99 out of every 100 members, but great fear came upon all the church. Let me tell you, it's a wonderful and a glorious thing. Divine revelation. When the blessed Holy Ghost opens up the Word to us and says, this is the way of walk in it.
Yes.
If we make our commitment, yes, that's the way I will walk. But it's a serious thing if we break that covenant and fail to follow through with it, and every member of the church of God should be afraid of what will happen to them.
Amen.
If they're not faithful to what they have promised God.
Amen.
Now, I'm not saying that there are not even a more worthy motivations, okay? Such as loving God and wanting to please Him. Oh yes. I put some things on what's the word I'm after?
Pedestal.
On a higher pedestal than I do others. As to what our motivations should be. But I tell you, it is contrary to Scripture. If we talk about the motivations for righteous living, and we leave the fear of God off the list,
Amen. It
is heresy that would say that should be left off the list.
Yeah.
It is sound Bible doctrine. We see it right here in the Scripture that great fear came upon all the church.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Upon all the church and upon his many. Has heard these things. But thank God for verse 12. As a result of that great fear, and by the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders wrought among the people. Hallelujah. And we read in verse 14, and believers were the more added to the church, multitudes, both of men and women. Insomuch that they brought forth the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at least the shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow some of them. The glory of the latter house is going to be greater than that of the former. Jesus said, the things that I do, greater than these shall ye do. But it's not... It ain't so. It's not going to happen. Do you hear me? Until that great fear comes upon all the church. A fear of displeasing God. Really, that should be the greatest fear of all. I love him so much. I have a fear of displeasing him because I love him. I want to be sure to please him. But still, it is heresy, it is false doctrine to lead the wrath of God out of the motivation. And if people are faithful to the covenant that they made with God, and they're faithful to a theocratic government, and they have a submissive spirit, and they're observing all things, the floodgates of heaven are going to open up, and God, we're going to see signs and wonders and miracles even more so than what we see here in Acts 5. Some wonderful things happen in Acts 5. But not before great fear came upon all of the church. In Acts chapter 20, Paul, in giving his farewell address to the Ephesian elders, beginning verse 17, and from Miletus he sent to Ephesus and called all the elders of the church. And when they were come to him, he said unto them, ye know from the first day that I came into Asia, after what manner I have been with you at all seasons. He said in verse 20, and how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you.
verse 21, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God. Verse 26, wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. I preach repentance. I hadn't left anything out of the message that God has given me. Verse 27, for I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. But notice in verse 31 he said, therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn. Could everybody say warn?
Warn.
He kept warning and warning and warning and warning and warning. For 3 years, I didn't quit warning you. I ceased not to warn everyone, night and day, with tears. Amen? That's where it's at. Charity. Love. We don't rejoice in iniquity. It breaks our heart when we see people unfaithful and break their covenant. But because we love people, we must warn them without ceasing. God help the ministry of the Church of God.
Amen.
That they'll follow the example of the Apostle Paul.
Amen.
Somebody said, well, you follow his example. He said, I've determined to know nothing among you except Christ and him crucified. Well, the same man said right here, I cease not to warn. That is a part of preaching the cross of Jesus Christ. You can't leave out those words, that none should perish. Yes, preach his love. Preach faith. Believe. Preach they'll have eternal life. But you can't leave out the part about the perishing. And the warning. And warning continually. We must warn people. We are not declaring the whole counsel of God if warning is not a part of what we're preaching and teaching. First Corinthians chapter 10. Verses 21 and 22. Ye cannot drink the cup of the Lord. And that's a book that we're supposedly doing this series in. It's Paul's first letter to the church of God at Corinth. 1 Corinthians 10, 21, 22. Ye cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils. Ye cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and of the table of the devils. Do we provoke the Lord to jealousy? And yes, we certainly do. When we do things as members of the Church of God that are abominable in His sight. Now I tell you, I'm just preaching what the Lord gave me. And maybe the Lord wants to move on us here tonight to have a spirit of concern and compassion, because we've got some faithful people here tonight. Almost reminds me, somebody said, preacher, if they'd have been here, you sure would have hit them. But we need to get a vision.
Amen.
The faithful need to get a vision of the seriousness of those who are not faithful, that their souls are hanging in the balance, that we'll get the spirit of the Apostle Paul, who shed tears night and day for 3 years as he warned them. Ephesians chapter 5, beginning verse 5. I'll read verse 3. It said, but fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be once named among you as becometh saints. Then verse 5, for this ye know that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man who is an idolater hath any inheritance in the kingdom of God. Let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Here Paul, he's not sending a letter to some pagan temple in the city of Corinth. He is writing to the church of God. And he's giving forth a warning concerning a sinful living to the members of the church of God. And he said, because of these things, cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. He wrote the same way to the church at Colossae. In chapter 3, beginning verse 1, if you then be risen with Christ, writing to the Colossians about the colossal Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above. Amen. Number one, the first and greatest commandment is to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, mind, soul, and strength. The first commandment is not to fear the wrath of God.
Above.
But what I'm saying, there's more than just one commandment. So yes, set your affection on things above. For you're dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. But when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall you also appear with Him in glory. Thank God for the colossal Christ. Thank God for love toward Him and setting our affections on heavenly things. But verse 5 said, mortify therefore. How about that? That word therefore tells us what the previous verses are therefore. Since you do love Him, since your affections are on things above, mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness. Since you observe that first and greatest commandment, and you love the Lord with all of your heart, and you set your affections upon things above, then mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry, for which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience, in the which ye also walked sometime when ye lived in them, but now ye also put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that you have put off the old man and his deeds, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of Him that created him. We need to put off all these things, because the wrath of God cometh upon the children of disobedience. The book of Jude. Oh, it describes false prophets and such evil men. And some of these seemingly having departed from the way of truth. But at the end of the book, course, just one chapter. Verse 17, he said, "But beloved, remember ye the words which were spoken before of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ." And in verse 19, referring back to these evil men that the rest of the book had described, he said, "These be they who separate themselves, sensual, having not the Spirit." But notice verse 22 and 23, "And of some have compassion." Oh God, give us a compassionate heart. Even for men as wicked as the scribe in these earlier verses in the book of Jude. "And of some have compassion," but it said making a difference. "And others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh." God help us that we'd be so full of the Holy Ghost that we would know what to say and how to say it.
Amen.
We're to have compassion for everybody. But the way we express that in trying to help them may not be the same with every person.
Amen. Yes.
Amen.
With some, you're going to have to look them straight in the eyes and let them know if things aren't changed, you're going to experience the judgment and the wrath of God. And just come on strong with that. And others, you may use a different approach to express the same truth and the same compassion. "And of some have compassion, making a difference, and others save with fear." That's the object of it all. We're not trying to send people to hell. We're trying to help them be saved from that awful place.
Yes.
But a part of that effort must be to warn them that the wrath of God comes upon the children of disobedience. Hebrews chapter 12, beginning verse 25. As I shared with you this morning concerning the Old Testament and the wrath of God and the fear of God, those things were written for our learning.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 12, verse 25, referring back to some of those things in the Old Testament, said, "See that ye refuse not him that speaketh, for if they escape not who refused him that spake on earth," probably a reference to Moses in the context here, "much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven," referring to the Lord Jesus Christ,
yes,
"whose voice then shook the earth." That's in the days of Moses. "But now he hath promised, saying, yet once more I shake not only the earth, but also the heavens." He shook the earth in Moses there. That mountain, it was on fire. It quaked. People feared to get close to it. But God says, "I'm going to do a greater shaking in the last days than what I did in Moses' time. I'm not just going to shake the earth only, but also the heaven." And this word, "yet once more," he's going to do a shaking once more again in these last days, signifies the removing of those things that are shaken as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Jesus Christ is going to sweep his house.
Amen.
He's going to wash his house with water by the word. He's going to cleanse it, a sanctify it. He is going to plot his will in his house, in the church of God, to where there will no longer be anything in it that's displeasing to him. He is going to shape his house to where everything that can be shaken out will be shaken out, so only that which cannot be shaken will remain. I want to be among those that are left in Zion. Now, I know there are those that believe in theocracy so much that they think that they are a theo. And I don't want to be labeled with that. But we should have a desire to be like Christ, to be like our righteous God. He is a jealous God. Let me tell you, I am a jealous pastor. Amen. I don't want to see my members. I love them. I don't want to see them caught up in other things and becoming more committed to that than they are to truth. Amen. And to God and to the church of God.
Amen.
I have a righteous jealousy. Amen. And I believe it should be that it's God-like, and that we should all have a righteous jealousy. We are part of one another. Amen. And what I'm saying is, I want to be left in Zion. When the sweeping takes place, when the whip pops, when the shaking is done, I want to be left in Zion. But I want you to be left in Zion. I want you to be left in Zion. I want you to be left in Zion. I'm a jealous pastor. Hallelujah. I want my children to be left in Zion. I want my grandchildren to be left in Zion. We are to be compassionate. We are to be loving, but a part of that love is the sound, the trumpet of warning. Because we're getting closer to the end time. And without a doubt, people that we love will be shaken out. Said, wherefore we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved. Hallelujah. Christ is going to have a kingdom that cannot be moved. Let us have a grace where we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Yes. There it is. This is in the verses that's talking about this shaking. And it says to serve God with reverence and godly fear. And the next verse said, for our God is a consuming fire. How plain can the scripture get?
Serve God.
Sometimes I almost preach so much message at home before I preach it at church. I get to feeling it so much, talking to my wife, and she'll hear it. And believe it or not, she's a preacher too. So she is. When I was sharing with her what I was feeling the Lord wanted to share with you today. And I had mentioned to her about, here's a parent, got kids maybe 3 and 4 years old, trying to teach them not to play in the street.
dangerous to play in the Spirit. And I believe I touched on that this morning. But you see, here's somebody, they see your 3 or 4 year old getting close to the road, and they run and grab and pick up that child before it steps out into traffic. And my, you get them trouble. That's my child, you leave my child alone. I know they're not supposed to play in the road, but they're not in the road. No. That's not what we do, amen. Well, what about in the church of God? And my wife, she said, Roger, she said, I was reading something on, I believe, the internet. Just yesterday, but and this one it was. Is it Facebook? Okay. To the woman, and this is near Alice's hometown. It's in the county. I guess the same county where she lived on the farm 16 years until I took her away. To the woman who lives on Highway 15 in Lee County, right around Ashwood Lake, or in the vicinity. Or if you know her with the big playground ship in the front yard, please, please tell her the next time her toddler runs out into the middle of Highway 15, because she is not supervising them. And the vehicles in both directions have to slam on their brakes and sit and wait for her to stroll out and collect them. Not running, but walking at a leisurely pace.